Okay, I think we'll get started as we've got quite a lot of content to move through. So hello and welcome to August Fearless Friday webinar. I'm Clare Stinton, financial wellbeing analyst here at Hargreaves Lansdown. It's no secret that the rising cost of living is having a huge impact on personal finances nationwide. Life is getting more expensive, and that can have consequences for both our short-term and long-term financial resilience. So it's really important that we know how to best navigate our finances in this tough economic climate. Not to mention, it's a pretty fluid situation. So just this month, we've seen inflation drop sharply. We've seen yet another interest rate rise, and there was an Ofgem energy price cap announcement this morning. The one thing that does appear to be consistent is that people are concerned about the rising cost of living. Though our money isn't going as far, but the pressure and pain points will differ for us on an individual basis. I'm really delighted to be joined by Ola, the founder of All Things Money, which is an online platform designed to provide information and tools to help young adults navigate the world of money. Ola, can you tell us a bit more about what you get up to at All Things Money?
Yes, so hello everyone, firstly. And like Claire kindly mentioned, I am the founder of All Things Money, which is an online platform, predominantly online, and with our podcast that teaches young adults how to manage their finances. Well, young adults and beyond, to be honest, because I feel like everyone needs to be given the tools to be well equipped to navigate adulthood, as I'm sure many of you guys can agree. We're not taught much about money or finances in school or university. So, yeah, All Things Money pretty much does all of that to hopefully empower the next generation of people and beyond, really.
Thanks, Ola. So over the next hour or so, we're going to be discussing how you can give your finances some TLC. But before we do go any further, just a bit of housekeeping to cover off. So there will be time at the end for questions. So do raise those through the Q&A and we'll look to answer as many as we can at the end of the session. I do need to stress that everything discussed today is purely information. It's not financial advice. And given the time constraints, it's not fully exhaustive, but we do hope that what we talk through will enable you to make decisions from a more informed position. And also, this session is being recorded, so you will be able to go back and watch everything on demand. A quick look at today's agenda. So we're going to begin with the bigger picture, exploring the causes behind the cost of living crisis and the stark reality that many nationwide now face. From here, we'll then hone in on why the Bank of England is increasing interest rates and what that means for us as borrowers, savers, or spenders. There could be some light at the end of the tunnel. Inflation is falling, and so is the cost of energy. And then, with our income not stretching as far, we'll also spend some time identifying ways in which you can shave money off your bills. I do think it's really important to be upfront with this. Unfortunately, there isn't a miracle cure. It will be a case of the collective power when making various lifestyle tweaks, and it will require a little bit of what we all term life admin. And then, if you're in a fortunate enough position to have some money left over at the end, then Ola and I are going to signpost the ways that you can look to build your financial resilience. Ola, it makes for pretty scary reading that one in four households are overspending. They're spending more than they're earning, which isn't sustainable. Why is it so important that we all try and live within our means?
Yeah, good question, Claire. I think it's really important that we try and live within our means as it reduces the need to borrow money. Although some of us may be fortunate enough right now to have a pot of savings, unfortunately, those savings don't last forever. So obviously, borrowing money, especially now as interest rates increase, it can be pretty expensive, which is why we really want to reduce the likelihood of overspending and avoid borrowing money as much as we can. Obviously, as well as the cost of borrowing money, once you do fall into debt, sometimes it can be very easy to find ourselves in a debt spiral if the debt becomes unmanageable. So having to pay off debt slowly over time eats into the amount of disposable money we are left with, which can then also reduce how much we're then able to save or invest into our future. So ideally, if you can, look to reduce your chances of overspending. And again, we'll be sharing some tips on how to kind of budget effectively in a minute.
Thank you. I mean, it is inevitable that we're all likely going to be in debt at some point in our lives. Not all debt is bad. In fact, actually, it's a necessity for the majority of us if we look to buy a property or if we want to attend university. But what's concerning is that we're seeing an increased credit and debt reliance fueled by the cost of living crisis. So actually, one in eight people are now borrowing just to fund those daily essentials. Households really have been in the trenches for 2 years or more now. First the pandemic, now the cost of living crisis. Ola, how have we ended up here? Why is the UK in the depth of a cost of living crisis?
Yeah, so there's many different reasons, but as I'm sure you guys know, we are sadly experiencing rising costs, and the UK is currently experiencing this cost of living crisis due to a number of factors, such as the increased cost of food. So retail prices for food and drink items have risen sharply in the last year. This is sadly as a result of the ongoing war in Ukraine, rise in production costs and increased travel costs. We've also experienced a huge labour shortage resulting in lack of HGV drivers as a result of COVID and Brexit, which has also increased the cost of food. The rising cost of energy, sadly, has also put a strain on households being able to pay for their energy bills. Fingers crossed there's light at the end of the tunnel with that one. We have also seen a rise of inflation, which has in turn increased interest rates, which will impact the cost of many people's mortgage repayments across the UK. So as we can kind of see, we're kind of being squeezed from loads of different points, which again has resulted in the cost of living crisis, because as a result of all this, the cost of living has just become more expensive.
You just mentioned inflation, which has been in the headlines a lot. Can we just explain what inflation is?
Yes, so inflation is the rate at which prices for goods and services rise over time. So, for example, I'm sure you guys have noticed that the average cost of your food shop has gone up, or even the cost to fill up your car. I mean, petrol down the road from me has gone up again. So these are two very basic examples of inflation. But inflation is measured by the Office for National Statistics. I'm not sure if you guys have heard of them before, but each month the Office for National Statistics collects around 180,000 prices of about 700 items, and the percentage change in the price of these items is then used to work out the consumer price index, which is the most common measure of inflation. So the government aims to keep inflation at around 2%. However, in July, it was around 6.8%. So we do have a long way to go to kind of bring down inflation rate at the moment in the UK.
Yeah, and that basket of items is actually constantly updated to reflect our shopping trends. So in 2021, gold chains were removed and hand sanitizer went in, unsurprisingly. Yeah. And I think that the most recent change is adding frozen berries, but removing Alka-Pops. So I'm guessing that WKDs aren't the drink of choice for young adults anymore.
Really not.
No. At 6.8, inflation is still more than three times what the Bank of England targets at 2%, which does explain why we're seeing rising interest rates, because actually that's the main tool that the bank have at their disposal to bring down persistently high inflation. The theory being that by raising interest rates, it makes it more expensive to borrow money, so people are less likely to spend. It'll mean that businesses and people spend less, the demand will decrease, and prices will fall, resulting in lower inflation. So the impact of higher interest rates will really differ depending on whether you're a saver or a spender. The average interest rate on credit cards is now at 31.2%, whereas actually some offer much lower rates, around the 10% mark. So it really does pay for people to do their research, to do a shop around. Some credit cards will also offer an introductory interest-free credit for a time period, but do remember to consider the affordability and the time period in which you're going to have to pay that off. What does rising interest rates mean for savers? How can they ensure that they get the best rate on their hard-earned money, Ola?
Yeah, so in a weird way, high interest rates means better news for savers. So as interest rates rise, banks will typically increase the amount of interest offered on your savings accounts. So what this means is that the higher the interest rate offered, the more you guys attending and those in the UK will be paid to store your savings away. So like you mentioned, it's really important to look out for high interest savings accounts. So again, you'll get paid more. So to ensure you get the best rate on your savings accounts, I always recommend checking comparison websites to make sure you're getting paid the most amount of money for saving your cash.
Yeah, and sometimes the banks can be a little slow at passing that interest on. HL actually has active savings, which will enable people to pick and choose from competitive rates. And that's from a variety of banks and lenders. And you can do that all through one online account. So really simple and hassle-free. Ola, there's lots of economist words being bandied around in the news at the moment. Is the UK headed for a recession? And if so, what would that mean for people like me and you?
Good question. So again, recession, I feel like there's so many new words being bandied around in the news. But when it comes to a recession, it's really hard to predict whether or not there will be a recession in the UK. However, if we do end up in a recession, then sadly, you could expect to see some people losing their jobs, as in unemployment typically rises during a recession. It also may be a little bit harder to get a pay rise. If you're currently investing in the stock market or have a pension, you may see a slight drop in your returns, but that's not the be all or end all, because as we know, markets can rebound. A rise in interest rates also might go up, as we've already seen, to try and slow down the rate of inflation back to that target of 2%, which, like I said, may be good for savers, but it might be slightly worrying for those borrowing money or have mortgages, especially if you're coming towards the end of your fixed rate term.
Absolutely. Speaking to clients and friends, the primary concern has been the impact of mortgage rates. And that's unsurprising, given that houses are the most expensive thing that we buy and we borrow for. What guidance can you share for those people hoping to buy their first home? As mortgage rates climb, how can people reach that goal?
Yeah, good question. Again, I feel like a lot of people, young people especially, because I work with a lot of young people, feel like buying a home is out of their reach. However, there are ways that we can kind of get onto the property ladder a little bit quicker. So one of my first tips is to work out a savings goal. So many people tell me that they want to save for a house, but then they don't know how much they need to save. So working out a savings goal is really, really important to work out how much you need to save on either a monthly or yearly basis. So with this, I tend to work backwards. So for example, if I need to save maybe £30,000 over 3 years for my house deposit, then I would divide £30,000 by 36 months, because obviously there's 12 months in a year, which will enable me to see that I would need to save around £830 roughly a month to reach that goal in the next 3 years. So yeah, start with that savings goal to see how much you actually need to save, because again, it's hard to save without knowing how much you need to save. Tip number two, try and find creative ways to increase your income to help contribute to your savings. So again, we know that salaries aren't really increasing that much at the moment. So again, it's really important that we're finding ways to increase our income, which what I know we'll be sharing some tips on how you can kind of maximize your income. Tip number three, utilize government schemes such as the Help to Buy ISA if you already have one, or you can look at opening up a lifetime ISA, as both of these ISAs are government schemes where the government tops up your savings by 25% for every £1 deposited. So I know I'm only 25, but I've never seen any savings accounts offer 25% interest. So if you're looking to boost your savings accounts, then these ISAs can be great if you're looking to purchase your first home. Sadly, the Help to Buy ISA is no longer available. However, the Lifetime ISA could be a suitable option if you're yet to purchase your very first home. This, with the Lifetime ISA, it's important to note that you can only save up to £4,000 a year. But like I said, the government will top that up by 25%. So that's an extra £1,000 if you manage to hit £4,000. And then also, it's really important to note that the Lifetime ISA can only be used to purchase your first home or for retirement. Otherwise, a 25% penalty will apply if you decide to access your savings any earlier. So please note that. And lastly, if possible, I know it's not a possibility for everyone, but you can look to consider purchasing purchasing a property with a friend or family member, as this can help reduce how much you need to save for your deposit and might be able to help you out with your affordability checks as well. So yeah, those are some of my quick tips in terms of anyone looking to buy their first home.
Thanks, Ola. All super useful. It's a slightly different story for those who are already on the property ladder and are due to remortgage in the coming months. So the big question there is, are more rises on the horizon? With inflation remaining above the bank's 2% target, it's likely, and some economists are predicting that the base rate could peak at 5.75%. Others are predicting 6%. So what can you do if your remortgage is looming? So firstly, it's worth knowing that you can typically renew up to 6 months prior to your expiry date, which means that you can actually start conversations with mortgage advisors 6 months before. You could consider overpaying your mortgage. So if you're already on top of expensive short-term borrowing and you already have an emergency rainy day savings net, then you could look to overpay by up to 10% a year, and that's usually within the terms of the deal. But do check to make sure that you won't face any penalties. Money is really tight for many right now, so that might not be an option, but perhaps something to consider if you get a pay rise or any lump sums. Another option is to consider extending your loan term. So lenders have agreed with the government that borrowers will be able to extend their term for 6 months without going through the approvals process. And that means without impacting your credit record. So it's worth bearing in mind that this means repaying for longer, so you'll end up paying more overall. But if you end up extending the mortgage term permanently, you do need to think about those potential implications. Another option is switching to interest only for a period, and that would of course decrease your monthly payments because you'll only be paying off the interest and not paying off any of the loan. And again, the government has made it easier for you to do this on a temporary basis, again, up to 6 months without affecting your credit score. But again, this will mean that you will need to extend your term when you switch back, and you'll need to make higher monthly payments. So it is one for careful consideration. Do reach out to a mortgage advisor if you do have any questions on that. And you can look at it from another perspective as well. So perhaps are there more ways for you to generate extra cash to meet those extra mortgage payments? So for instance, do you have a spare room that you could rent out and earn extra money from? And in some cases, selling up and downsizing could be an option to reduce monthly outgoings. If there are no other options left, it is worth speaking to your lender and seeing if that they can help. They could be prepared to change their payments or arrange a payment deferral. Ultimately, it is in their best interest that they do help, but just be aware that actually it will affect your credit score if you do go down that route, and it could affect and raise costs later, but it will certainly do less damage than missing payments without any notice. Moving now to energy, may there be some light at the end of the tunnel with regards to this. So Ola, I really welcome news that the Ofgem energy price cap dropped in July. So we're all paying less per kilowatt of energy. And today it was announced it will drop again in October by another £100 to around £1,920 average spend. So it's moving in the right direction, but we're still paying a lot more than we did a couple of years ago. We're approaching autumn. What can people do to reduce their energy costs?
Yeah, so like you said, it's not like one wave of the magic wand that's going to make it our bills zero, but there are a few things you can do. So tip number one I have is to make sure to turn off any standby appliances at the plug, as this can actually save an average of £60 a year. Now, I know I'm very guilty of it at home because my mum goes on about it all the time, and I know some of you guys are thinking that's really simple. So yeah, again, just reminding yourself to turn off these appliances that you're not maybe using, even if your socket is switched on at the plug, just turn it off. Again, make sure you remember that. Tip number two, turning down your thermostat can also help reduce your energy costs as well. So by turning your heating down by just 1 degree, the average household can actually save roughly around £145 a year. So again, that is a huge saving just from like 1 degree down in your thermostat. Tip number three, consider washing your clothes at a lower temperature. So by washing your clothes at 30 degrees rather than 40 degrees can help you reduce your energy usage as well. So by doing this and reducing your wash cycle per week, you could save up to around £30 a year. Also, again, sometimes it's annoying that you have to spend money to save money, but you could look at purchasing a water efficient shower head, as by doing this could also save the average home as much as around £50 on energy bills a year as well. And also you can look at purchasing draft excluders as well. So they help seal cracks between your doors and also your letterbox. And this can also help reduce your energy bill or your heating bill by up to £58 a year as well. So that's nearly a £300 saving just by those five tips.
All great tips. I think the boiler one is particularly a no-brainer, because for anything like me, I'll run the hot water but then add in a bit of cold to cool it down, which of course doesn't make any sense. I think I've certainly noticed that I've made a conscious effort to try and only boil the kettle with the water that I need rather than overfilling it. It's those small everyday tweaks. People could also consider picking up an energy consumption meter. That can really help you keep track of your usage, so you can identify those small changes that will have the biggest impact. Moving now to looking at ways to free up spare cash. So the first essential step really is assessing your incomings and outgoings. We heard earlier that some people are spending more than they're earning, and a budget could really help here. In my experience, the term budgeting does have negative connotations. People often think it means restrictions or adopting a basic standard of living. Others may think that they earn too much money actually to need to worry about a budget. Some may hear it and think that's more life admin and I'd rather avoid that. Ola, what are the benefits to budgeting or let's call it smart spending?
Yeah, I always talk about budgeting online. So if anyone follows me, then they know how much I love a budget. But budgeting is probably more important than ever now, as it allows us to stay in control of our finances by helping us track and review where our money is going. Because I don't know about you guys, but there's been many times back in the past where I'd spend all my money and have no clue where it went. So creating a budget really helps us identify all of these pain points. I also say it's really important that you can budget and have fun, as it doesn't have to be complicated at all. But when it comes to budgeting, it's all about being wise with our money. So there's a few easy steps you can take, which is by reviewing your direct debits. Is there anything you no longer need anymore? Maybe making easy switches, so preparing lunches at home rather than spending all of your hard-earned cash at Starbucks or Costa every day. I used to be guilty of this at uni. Or even just taking a look at your regular spending habits and seeing if there's anything you can cut out or swapping them for cheaper alternatives. So there's a few like beauty regimes I've had to reduce. I mean, I still get my nails done, but there's other things I've had to cut out because at the moment it's just money I don't need to be spending. So yeah, not only does a budget allow us to track and review our spending, but it also enables us to plan for our future too. So again, if you're maybe looking to purchase your first home, buy a car, go on holiday, a budget allows you to do that as well.
Absolutely. We actually have a budgeting tool on our website that can help people do the maths and be smarter with their spending. Just do remember, if you're completing this, this calculator will produce a snapshot of your budget at one moment in time based on the information that you provide. So do get into the habit of reviewing it regularly, and it's a living calculator, so it does need to flex with any changes to your income or life events. So for instance, if you move house and therefore your mortgage payments change, or the rent changes, or if you have a child, then it's an obvious time to go back at your budget and review it. I will drop a link to that into the chat at the end of the session so that you can access that on the website. Ola, on screen is an example of a budgeting model. Can you walk our audience through it?
Yes. So a great method of budgeting I like to share, which many of you guys would have heard of if you follow me online, is the 50-30-20 budgeting method. So I know lots of people favour this budgeting method, as it allows you to kind of allocate your money according to your needs, wants and savings. So the idea behind this rule is that 50% of your income should be spent on your needs. So this will consist of paying your rent, bills, food shopping, and anything else you class as necessary spending. Sadly, a shopping trip does not fall into this category, so please be mindful of that. And also, like I said before, it's important that you can budget and have fun. So with this budgeting method, 30% of your income can then be allocated for your wants. So this balance can be spent on whatever you like to spend your money on, whether that's going to the shops, a trip to the cinema, eating out, etc., etc. And then the remaining 20% of your income is for future you. So this money should ideally be put aside into a separate savings pot, into the set stock market if you'd like to start investing, to help you generate wealth for the long term. So those are the three ways you can kind of allocate your money with this budgeting method. However, I know not everyone could rigidly stick this guideline, especially maybe if you live in London, where rent is probably more than 50% of your income. So again, you can kind of readjust these budgets or categories to kind of suit your financial situation. So yeah, if it's like a 60-20-20 split, or if it's like a 70-10-5 split — that was really bad maths, but you get the gist — you can always readjust those allocations as much as you want.
I think that's the key thing, isn't it? There isn't a one fits size all approach with budgeting, because it's so individual to the person that's doing it. Yeah. What tips can you share to help keep people on track with their finances? So if they've got a budget, what can they do to try and stick to it?
Yeah, so there's many ways, like you can see on the screen. But one of my number one tips that I always love is to pay yourself first. So by doing this, you can consider opening up a separate bank account to budget your money effectively. So for me, I use two bank accounts, and I transfer my weekly budget into a separate account just to make my budget more manageable. So I actually spend on one card with my weekly budget, and I know that's all I can spend for the week. But if you don't fancy opening up a separate bank account — so I know some people are skeptical about many banks that are up and coming at the moment — then you can also consider cashing out your budget instead, so you can actually visibly see how much money you can afford to spend instead. I used to do this during university, and it was a very good deterrent for overspending, because scientifically you spend less when you can actually see the money in your hand, because it's a lot more painful. And there's also lots of different budgeting apps out there now that are designed to help you budget better. So like we said before, you know, there doesn't have to be an old traditional way of budgeting anymore. There's so many apps out there that can help do the hard work for you.
That is so true, isn't it? I think if you're buying something online and you're just popping in your security digits from your card, really doesn't feel like you're spending money in comparison to if you had the cash. Yeah. I know something that really works for me is the separate savings account, because it's very much out of sight, out of mind, as well as anything automated, because let's face it, life is really busy. So setting up a direct debit to collect your savings on payday actually really helps you stick to a healthy habit. I also find the roundup feature on some banking apps can be another really great way to save. And that's where you can set an instruction to round up transactions to the nearest pound. So if you spend £3.30 on a flat white, then 70p will be removed and automatically put into a separate savings pot. It's actually really amazing how quickly that adds up, with really little impact to your day-to-day spending habits. So we've just looked at how budgeting can really help us identify areas of wasteful spending, so that we can redirect that money to savings or to spend it on what we enjoy doing. When it comes to cutting costs, it is a case of trimming the fat. So those small tweaks together can have that really big impact. Unfortunately, falling inflation doesn't necessarily mean falling prices. They are perhaps just rising at a slower pace than they were before. And increased food costs are really piling on the pressure for household budgets. There is a difference depending on what we choose to eat for breakfast. So remember that the Bank of England targets 2% annual inflation. If you like low-fat milk on your morning cereal, then that's actually up nearly 11% on this time last year. And if you reach for eggs, actually that's up an eye-watering 26.7%. Inflation has dropped, and hopefully that does mean that we'll start to see lower prices passed on by the supermarkets to consumers. I've certainly noticed that shoppers have changed their behaviour when I've been shopping over the last year or so. More and more families are going up and down the aisle with their phone calculator out, or perhaps telling the assistant at the checkout to stop at a certain monetary amount because they have a budget that they need to stick to. Ola, what are some of the ways that households can cut food, cut costs on their food?
Yes, so one of my biggest tips is to consider when to go shopping. So when shopping for groceries, consider maybe going towards the end of the day if you can, as this is where you can often find plenty of yellow sticker reduced foods. My Tesco is great for that. We've also got Co-op as well that do great deals at the end of the day. So if you can maybe go after work, or be smart about where you're at when you actually do shopping, I always recommend going in the evenings. Tip number two, sign up for supermarket loyalty schemes. If you haven't already, make sure you sign up to schemes such as Tesco Club Card and the Lidl Plus app, as this will enable you to take advantage of further discounts on your food shop. Utilise cash back apps such as Shopmium and Cheddar. Again, if you haven't already used them, please do. They will enable you to earn a certain percentage of your money back for when shopping for groceries. So make sure you download these apps before your next food shop. They're my favourite. Also, if you can, consider shopping with cards that also offer cash back. So for example, Chase Bank is currently offering users 1% back on all of your purchases with their Chase card. So definitely recommend checking them out as well, because I know some people are often quite skeptical about cashback, but those tips are tried and tested by yours truly. So yeah, I highly recommend them.
That's interesting, isn't it, actually? Because a couple of the loyalty cards that now at some of the big four supermarkets, if you don't have the card, actually you can pay sometimes double the price for the same item. So it makes a huge difference to your overall bill. I think there's also trolley.co.uk, which compares groceries at over 16 different stores. So everything from Asda to Tesco to Sainsbury's, even Amazon. And it's perhaps particularly helpful if you're really fortunate to have a selection of those stores on your doorstep, or if you're perhaps looking to purchase branded items or toiletries that might run at a higher cost, and you can check where those might be on offer. Not all of those tips on the screen are going to work for everyone. It is a case of people picking and choosing where they're happy to make the tweak and what will work for them and their lifestyle. Ola, you openly talk about side hustles as a really good way to earn more money outside of your everyday. Do you have a side hustle? And also, what are some of the ways for people to free up extra cash?
Yes, a good question. So funnily enough, All Things Money started off as my side hustle, but it's now my job. But I'm not saying every side hustle needs to be a full-time job. But back in the day, I used to take part in online surveys and paid focus groups whilst I was at university. I should have been at lectures, but most of my time was keen on making money. I also used to sell a lot of my old clothes and make extra cash that way too, especially during sick form. But there's other ways people can make some free cash, such as utilising cashback websites. So websites such as Quidco and Top Cashback, as they reward you cashback for free, guys. So you don't have to have a paid membership for this, just for shopping as you normally would. Taking advantage of bank switching offers. So some banks are currently offering up to £200 for free just to switch over to them. I mentioned that I've been to Ibiza twice this year, so I actually used one of my free bank switching incentives to cover the second cost of my Ibiza trip. Also, look at downloading receipt scanning apps such as ShopX, who will pay you to scan your receipts. Again, just for literally shopping in the supermarket, upload your receipt onto the app. And again, it will give you some money for that. And then also there's apps such as We Are 8 that also just pay you to watch their ads on their platform. Now, we speak about extra cash. All the money generated isn't enough to obviously replace your income or your salary, but it's always kind of good to find these creative ways to just kind of add on the extra spare change to kind of cover any rising costs.
If only we were paid to watch the ads on TV, and then we'd all have a few extra pounds.
I'd be a millionaire.
We really would, wouldn't we? I actually recently managed to shave a few pounds off my monthly expenditure. And I think this is something that we're all quite guilty of. So I was due a phone upgrade, and I got offered an automatic deal, but did a bit of research online and actually managed to find the same deal, but a saving of £21 a month. And then went back to my current provider and they matched it. So I think particularly with mobile phones, it's really worth doing your research, because another thing is a lot of us are actually really guilty of overpaying our contract. So do check when yours is up for renewal, as the phone provider is unlikely to nudge you to let you know. And if you're happy with your current handset, actually, could you save yourself money by swapping from contract to SIM only instead of upgrading? So that's something else to think about as well. If people are in the fortunate position of having money left over each month, then their priority should be to look at building up their financial resilience. And that's really the first line of defense for any curveballs that life throws at us. At HL, we have created a simple and holistic blueprint to help people achieve financial security. There are five building blocks on the road to financial resilience. So the first is controlling debt, then looking at protecting you and your family. Next, save a penny for a rainy day, so that emergency cash buffer. Then moving on to planning for later life, so pensions, of course, are within that category. And then it's looking at investing to make more of your money, so growing your wealth. And broadly, we can split those five pillars into two sections. So protect your family and save a penny for a rainy day. They are ways to reduce risk, both everyday risk, but also the tragic, disastrous risk that very much we'd like to avoid. And then those remaining three pillars, control your debt, planning for later life, and investing, all focus on building a better financial future. Through our research, we found that too often individuals would look at aspects of their financial resilience in isolation. So, for example, you could be paying a really healthy contribution into your pension, but putting absolutely no money away for a rainy day, and that then leaves you vulnerable to a fluctuation in income. So by taking it back to basics and looking at these five pillars, people can approach them regardless of age, occupation, income level, financial knowledge and capability, and it therefore allows you to prioritize your vulnerabilities. So in this tough economic climate, short-term debt, costly debt should be prioritized. Once any debt's under control, then the next priority is looking at putting some money away and building an emergency fund. And then that protects you from any future road bumps. And then once you've built up your short-term resilience, it is time to think long-term and look at your building your pension pot so that you can retire on your terms at a later date. Because let's remember, our pensions are effectively going to pay for what is our longest ever holiday. So for the rest of today's session, Ola and I are going to focus on pillars 3 and 4. So first up, we're going to be looking at the YES Fund, or otherwise known as an emergency fund. Ola, what is a YES Fund and what could we use it for?
Yeah, so like you said, Claire, a YES Fund is basically another term for an emergency fund or a savings pot put aside for future use. So when it comes to working out how much you should have in a savings pot, it's typically recommended that you should have around 3 to 6 months worth of your expenses saved up towards your YES Fund. So obviously your expenses are all your necessary spending, like we touched on with the 50-30-20 budgeting method. However, due to the current circumstances, please don't worry if you don't currently have that amount of money saved up. So really, in an ideal world, you just want to have as much money possibly saved up to help you if the worst case scenario was to happen. So if you're not able to save 3 to 6 months worth of your expenses right now, then you may want to try and save around 10 to 20% of your income each month. But again, if you can't afford that, then ideally just as much as you can, just save as much as you can at the moment. And obviously, like we touched on earlier, when you're saving your money, I always recommend opening up a separate savings account, as it allows you to keep your savings set aside from your day-to-day spending.
And I think it's really important actually that we confirm that it's 3 to 6 months essential expenditure. So actually that's the needs, it's the necessities, it's not the wants. So it is a little easier to achieve than first thought. And it's really worthwhile even starting small and building that fund is better than not starting at all. Because what we really see is that small consistent habits can have that really big impact when it comes to your financial resilience. Next up, we're going to have a look at pensions. So there may be a temptation when your finances are stretched to cut back on pensions. That's particularly if you're a young adult. Pensions and retiring seem very far off in the distance. But we'd really urge people to bear in mind that hopefully the cost of living crisis will be relatively short-lived. We already know that as a nation, we're not saving enough into pensions. So we do need to consider and balance our longer term needs. You might not feel the pain of stopping pension contributions or reducing them now, but your future self certainly won't thank you. So Ola, what do those listening need to know about the gender pension gap to start with?
Oh, good question. So the gender pension gap is the percentage difference in pension income between female and male pensioners. As you can see from the slide, there is a huge difference in the average pension between male and females. Some of the reasons as to why the gender pension gap exists is because of the existing gender pay gap that already exists. So women are typically paid less compared to their male counterparts in the workplace, which already reduces the amount of money they are able to contribute towards their workplace pension. And also, women on average experience an increased amount of time out of the labour market in order to care for children and or other family members.
Absolutely. So it's a knock-on effect, isn't it? It's multifaceted in terms of why it exists. And actually, common sense suggests women would need a larger pot to provide an income for longer, because on average, we actually live 4 years longer than our male counterparts. Ola, how do pensions differ from other savings accounts? What makes them so tax efficient?
Good question. People always ask me this. So pensions are different to your typical savings account, as firstly, your pension is actually invested in the stock market. So loads of people say to me, oh, I don't invest in the stock market. But if you have a workplace pension, you actually are. So that's the main difference between your savings pot and your pension. Secondly, if you are auto-enrolled onto your workplace pension, your contributions are made from your pre-tax income. So this means that if you decided to contribute more towards your workplace pension, also known as salary sacrifice, you will actually get taxed slightly less because you are reducing your taxable income. Also, with your auto-enrolment, the legal minimum contribution is currently 8%, which is made of 5% from yourself and 3% from your employer. So you actually get free contributions into your pension pot too, unlike your savings pot. And also, to further encourage people to contribute to their pension, the government also pays tax relief on your pension contributions. So what this means is that depending on the amount of tax you pay, you'll get some money back in the form of tax relief. So if you're currently a basic tax rate payer, which most of you guys on this call might be, that means if you're currently paying 20% on your income, then you will actually get 20% back in the form of tax relief. So let's say, for example, if you contributed £100 towards your pension pot, you actually would have only paid £80. So again, yeah, there's huge difference between your savings pots and your pension. So ideally, if you can contribute to your workplace pension, definitely do.
Absolutely. And it's well worth checking with your employer if they do offer salary sacrifice, because that is the most efficient way of contributing. And some employers might be willing to contribute more than the legally required 3%. That's certainly the case with a few companies that I work with. Sometimes there will be an incentivized structure whereby if you pay more, actually, they'd be willing to contribute more as well. There are two main ways that we can boost our pension pots. And the self-explanatory is, of course, paying more money in. But actually, investment return is also really important. At a time when money is tight and people might not have the spare cash to uplift their contributions, investments and the returns that you achieve can have a huge impact on the value of the pension in later life. Why are investments so important for our long-term financial resilience?
Yeah, so when it comes to our pensions, that because as they're invested in the stock market, they help shelter our savings from inflation. So this is because the money we have now may not be worth the same amount in a few years' time. So because of this, investing can be a great way to build long-term wealth. The longer you are able to contribute to your pension and or invest in the stock market, the longer you are able to ride the waves of volatility. So that's when the stock market goes up and down, and hopefully allows you to achieve long-term growth as a result of compounding. So compounding, I don't know if you guys remember the term in maths, but compounding is where your money grows year on year on top of your hopefully already growing investments.
Yeah, and compounding is really where you start to earn returns on past returns, and it can really lead to a snowball effect, can't it? What do our audience need to know about the relationship between risk and reward? Because that's something that we typically find is one of the most commonly asked questions.
Yeah, so when investing in the stock market, there will always be an element of risk, sadly, and obviously no return is ever guaranteed. However, typically, the higher the amount of risk you're willing to take, there can be the potential for higher rewards.
And I would add there, if you are comfortable taking a more adventurous approach, then the earlier that you do that in the lifespan of your pension, theoretically, the better. And that's because if the stock market does downturn, then you have a much longer recovery period should you need it to ride out that downturn and hopefully achieve higher growth. And also bear in mind that if you are regularly contributing to your pension, you're buying in each month through a workplace pension, if the stock market does downturn, then actually there is opportunity within that, because you'll be buying in most likely a lower price, and therefore there's room for higher growth on the up cycle. We've talked about putting money aside if you have spare money left over, and the first priority is the YES Fund, that emergency cash savings pot, and then building long-term resilience through a pension. But you don't need spare cash to improve your financial well-being. What are some of the other things that people can do to improve their financial well-being, Ola?
Yeah, so that's a very good question as well. So number one, I would always say review all of your finances and accounts, as this will allow you to see where you're at financially. I offer one-to-ones, and I know many people like to bury their head in the sand, but sadly that won't help your financial well-being because it's the level of stress you're already experiencing. Tip number two, draw up a budget and write up a financial plan to help you regain control of your finances. So again, it's really important to actually create a plan rather than, again, ignore everything that's going on in the background. And tip number three, speak to someone. I think that's probably like the biggest takeaway I want anyone's takeaway from this session today, because obviously we know times are really hard. So whether that's a family member, friend, colleague, please speak to someone, as again, you know, sometimes we just like to kind of keep it all to ourselves, which doesn't always help. Obviously, if the idea of this is daunting, then you can take a moment to prepare how you're going to approach this conversation. So you can do this by carefully choosing who the best person is to talk to. So it might not be your immediate family member, it might be a colleague that you're close to, but ideally you want to speak to someone you're comfortably opening up to. Also, choose when the best time is to have this conversation. So it might be best to talk to this person one-on-one, when maybe at the end of the day, maybe in their mornings, because depending on when they're probably best able to listen to you. And also practice what you're going to say. Again, that can be really handy. And lastly, if you don't maybe have a close one that you can maybe speak to, seek professional help if they are unable, if you're unable to speak to someone else.
I think there's some really good tips in there. If you're struggling to speak to someone about money or raise that subject with friends or family, then an opener might be suggesting a podcast that's about money, or suggesting that if you've got a book club, that it's a book about investing or money, and then that can help lead into those conversations and do the first hard part for you. Finally, before we move to the audience's questions, what's the best piece of money guidance that you've been given that you'd like to pass on?
Oh, that's a good question. So if you have the disposable income, then I would always say to start investing. I used to overthink what investing meant, and I always thought only the rich can do it, but that certainly isn't the case. And I always say, if I can invest, then genuinely anyone can as well. Investing in the stock market can be a great way of building wealth over time, if done correctly and thorough research has been conducted. Platforms like Hargreaves Lansdown have now made it so accessible for people to get investing in the stock market with as little as £25 a month. So yeah, that would probably be my biggest tip of guidance I can give.
Yeah, absolutely. With the £25 a month, that can go directly into a fund, and a fund is a collective form of investment that's diversified, and you can have that invested by experts. So you can pay a small fee for them to do the research on your behalf. So moving now to our financially fearless community. So if you haven't already, please do join. You can sign up via the QR code on the screen, and do spread the word. Tell your mother, sister, daughters, partners, friends. And being part of the community actually means that you receive a weekly article. It's written by women for women, and you'll also continue to receive invites for these Fearless Friday webinars, which happen on the last Friday of every month. Please do keep popping your questions into the Q&A, and Ola and I will look to answer those in a minute or two's time. Before we do that, please take a couple of minutes to read through the important investment notes. And that's a slide from our compliance team. It really just reiterates that everything in this session was purely information. It's not to be considered as financial advice. Stock market investments can, of course, decrease as well as increase in value. And tax rules around pensions are subject to change. I'm afraid we will have to leave it there for now. I hope that you've enjoyed the session. I'm really sorry if we haven't got around to your question, but as I say, we will take those offline and we will circulate the answers following this. Final word from me is a huge thank you to Ola. I've really enjoyed talking to you today. So thank you for joining us. And I hope you all enjoyed listening. Thank you for your time, and hope you all enjoy the long weekend.